Colby, very interesting question I have to ask. Why is VMware even at a DevOps conference? Is VMware now DevOps?
We have plenty of tools that are catered to a DevOps audience. Mm-hmm. So as the ops teams become more and more relevant once again, mm-hmm. and being able to service developers, we have tools that will help them within the DevOps process and use DevOps principles. Mm-hmm. Whether it's infrastructure as code, being able to share that file across, or whether it's from a continuous delivery pipeline, being able to deliver what developers need.
But developers will say, yeah, this is just slowing me down here, right? It's VMware, they're gonna be behind 2-3 generations in OpenStack and Kubernetes and all of those solutions, right? I wanna develop against the native cloud API. What are you telling those guys?
Yeah, for those guys, that's why a lot of the reason we've moved to a SaaS model as well. So we're developing more and more of our software in SaaS.
Okay.
And that enables us every 2 weeks to have a sprint with new software, new releases, and updated software. So we can stay on the current trend of things as well as new technologies. It also allows the ops team to continually evolve their services. Mm-hmm. So they're still relevant in terms of, you know, developers having to wait on them for certain things. We want to eliminate those wait times and accelerate that. So they're not waiting on a developer. They can have what we call is we want to make the clouds really invisible. Mm-hmm. So whether it's a public cloud or a private cloud, developers don't care if they can get the services they need and get that in a timely manner.
Right. And VMware also has its own infrastructure as code. Right, and that infrastructure as code inside of the cloud assembly service is not a Terraform-based service. Why?
Right. That's a great question. So we do, within our cloud automation services, have a tool called Cloud Assembly, you're right, it has a GUI, it has YAML code, as well as an API. And within that, we didn't go with the Terraform code in the sense that Terraform is really about building for individual cloud types. Mm-hmm. So we've put a policy-based provisioning engine and cloud API across the clouds. So you can build it once and it's truly cloud agnostic and be able to deploy and offer up services across any cloud type.
So you have that concept of the unified operational model, which interestingly, it's the pendulum swinging back, I feel, at this conference a little bit, right? I hear speakers saying, oh, everything was for the developers over the last 10 years, right? All the cool new stuff is for the developers, and we kind of left ops out there to try, and we are finding now a new appreciation for the ops part, right? The challenge is to not slow the devs down at the same time.
You're right. I mean, devs have gotten agile. They're throwing more and more packets over the fence, but the ops team is just being inundated with those. So being able to keep up with that, being able to share that code across is something that's really important and something that can really help them accelerate what they do as well.
Mm-hmm. And the cloud services, Colby, are they replacing vRealize step by step?
That's a great question. So a lot of our customers really prefer the on-premises software. Mm-hmm. So we're not leaving it behind, but we will have all the code from our SaaS converge into our next major releases of vRealize. Mm-hmm. So if you think about Cloud Assembly, Service Broker, CodeStream, all that's going to be subsumed into vRealize Automation. So you're going to have all that goodness. We've built these services from the ground up. Mm-hmm. We also know the goodness and the things that these vRealize products are good at, but we will have that option for an on-premises software as well.
So there will be one unified code base for vRealize and the cloud services as well.
Exactly. One unified code base.
Thank you, Colby.